All right, we are on. Hello, and today I'm with Michael Vizdos. And is that how you pronounce your last name?
That's good.
Okay, very good. And Michael will be giving a session at the upcoming Agile Development Practices Conference in Las Vegas. So let's start off, Michael, and just have you talk a little bit about yourself and what you do and your career thus far.
So my name is Mike Vizdos. Thank you for having me on here today, too.
Yeah, definitely.
I've been in the Agile industry since about 2001 when really it kind of got started. I started out my career back in late 1989 with Ross Perot and Electronic Data System.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Spent 7 years there working with big system things. Worked on an operating system called OS2 for a while with IBM. And we broke off and started a hospital IT company, took that one public. Started another .com, which would turn into a .bomb, pretty drastic. Lots of lessons learned from that.
Yeah.
And started working with a guy named Scott Ambler back in 2001. We signed our first contract on the morning of September 11, 2001.
Wow.
So not a great day to start the company.
Yeah, I can imagine.
Over those 4 years, we were working with rep implementations, the rational unified process, and bound patterns that large enterprises had, and we wrote a book on that. During that time, I met Ken Schwaber and learned about Scrum.
Yep.
This certified Scrum master class from him back in like 2004. And
one of the first students. There you go.
Yeah, it was like the first, you know, 500. I think it was somewhere in there.
Yeah.
I started working with him and was intrigued because it was, you know, I was able to actually deliver software that people were using, which is kind of cool.
Uh-huh.
Because for the longest time, that really wasn't happening. So, you know, zoom ahead almost 10 years now, and I've been really spending a lot of time working with clients around the world, implementing Agile with different techniques. Scrum is one of them, and I do some of the test-driven development. I wouldn't consider myself an expert in the technology side and more of the facilitation side.
Mm-hmm.
I started the comic strip with the chicken and pigs about 2006.
Very cool.
At implementing Scrum. And people either love it or hate it. And, you know, I'm okay with one because it does spur conversations.
And are you working with primarily large organizations or small? I mean, what's the sort of clientele like?
Yeah, they're all over the map now, and I'm saying no to about 90% of the calls that come in.
Wow, okay.
Really, I'm looking for clients that really want to try to affect some kind of change. And
much easier said than done.
Yeah, and so, I mean, I spend a lot of time up front almost qualifying people to make sure that we're a good fit, because you know, I don't have a really good filter a lot of times. I do have some opinions and a lot of, you know, hard lessons learned that I like to share.
Mm-hmm. Gotcha. So the session you're going to be talking about is on innovation games. So I guess we could start off by just asking, you know, how did you get involved with these, with innovation games? How did you hear about it and how did you start implementing them?
I read a book from a guy named Luke Holman.
Uh-huh.
And Luke and I had bumped into each other at conferences over the years when we were both talking or speaking at them, and the book intrigued me, and I read it, and I thought, okay, well, here's a good tool to use at different points in, you know, the Agile development work, and I was like, okay, this is a great tool. He invited me to come to, I think it was San Francisco at the time, and take his class.
Mm-hmm.
As one of the innovation games facilitators, and I did that. And the real value for us was the connections that I made, the people that I met there. Really, just the top people in the industry were also there. And with any industry conference, it's less about the content of all of the sessions and more about the people that you do meet at these sessions.
The networking.
Yeah. It's vital that you make some really, really good connections.
Right.
That's been a huge part of my success over the years. You know, don't be afraid to talk to people. And yeah. I do invite people when they're there, let's talk, you know, whether it's innovation games or any other topic you want.
Right. Very cool. All right. So then let's just explain a little bit about innovation games. What are they?
So they're really a way to get people to collaborate And the session's really going to cover, you know, what is collaboration and why is it important. And it really does spur on a lot of information about when you don't have any collaboration, you're kind of screwed with, you know, conflict. Because there is no conflict because there's no trust. And it's really, this is a great tool, and there's a great set of tools within innovation games to allow people to use different techniques at different times to help eliminate that fear of conflict and kind of build more trust, which is really one of the cornerstones that, like, if you look at the five dysfunctions of teams, that right. talks about.
So it's sort of battling, and you said a fear of conflict. So that's interesting. It's not even necessarily the conflict that's there. It could be just the fear of leading into something or stepping on someone's toes or.
Yeah. Yep. And if you look at the, like, the Bruce Tuckman model where he talks about forming, storming, norming, and performing, you know, this is really helping teams get out of that storming phase where they've got to actually face the conflict and get out of it as a team.
And what are some examples of conflict that a team could be facing?
Oh, a lot of times people that I work with are introverts, I guess is the right word.
Sure.
So most of the people that in this industry, you know, we don't get energy from groups. And here we are in an agile world where people are throwing us into groups and saying, you know, work together.
Share your stories, start collaborating, do all this. Yeah, yeah.
What the heck? So it brings up a lot of problems. And what I see a lot is almost passive-aggressive behavior.
Mm.
You know, people that say, oh, yeah, we want to do Agile, and then they do everything they can to trip it up.
Ooh, and when they trip it up, I mean, what do you mean by tripping it up?
With any change, you want to go back to whatever you were doing before. So, you know, whether it's, you know, weight loss or quitting drinking or quitting smoking. You know, any kind of change is hard.
Oh, definitely.
So these innovation games really do help kind of work different ways in getting past that as a team.
Gotcha. All right, so let's talk about an example of an innovation game. And maybe we're dealing with some passive-aggressive people here.
Yeah, so one of the great ones that I use at retrospectives in, like, let's say a Scrum Agile team is something called Speedboat.
Speedboating.
Where we actually draw a speedboat, and I'm not really a good artist, by the way, up on the wall, and really have people just kind of put a scene around this speedboat. And it's a boat that's above water, and there's an anchor that goes down. People get pretty artistic about this, and it's kind of scary how artistic some of these things look. By the end. And really the purpose of this is to identify the good and the bad that's happening.
Yeah.
So instead of going through the, well, what went well, what didn't go so well, this really does help open up some different conversations around what is happening that's good and bad from many different points of view.
It's asking everyone to sort of contribute something to the overall, to the picture, the overall
yep.
picture, right?
Yep. And it really does give you a good indication as a group of, God, does this thing all suck?
Yeah.
Or are we, you know, are we doing well?
Are we a sinking ship?
Or yep. And most of the teams that I work with is on one extreme or the other. You know, they either want to up their game because they're a high-performing team, or they are totally screwed.
Very interesting.
Yeah.
How about another example of a type of game?
So maybe for prioritizing features. This is really in like the product backlog refinement.
Okay.
There's a game we play called Buy a Feature, and it really is. It's a competitive game to have people all get different kinds of money to say, okay, well, here's the feature list we have. Here's the money. Let's game on. Figure out, right?
Right.
Who's gonna get the highest value features? And it's good because really with that. Everybody doesn't get the same amount of money, so all the dynamics change in that game, which is really fun to watch.
And they're not given the same amount of money, so they're divvied up just random portions, maybe, and they
yeah.
have to do.
Yeah.
And how many people are usually involved in these games?
Anywhere from like 5 to 50 to
50.
Gosh, and if they do some of them that, you know, have 500 or 1,000. I mean, they're huge games these days.
Are these?
I haven't done any of those that big.
Are these games scalable? That like, you know, a game that could work with five teams can work with 500.
Yeah.
Or they have sort of okay, so they are okay. Wow.
And Luke has a lot of Luke Holman has a lot of these games online now, and I know he publishes a lot of stuff with work with cities and counties around the U.S.
Oh wow!
Especially on the left coast.
About
I've not been involved in any of those.
About how many games like are there? You know, is that that's a pretty broad question. But I mean, is there for people just getting into it? What can they expect? How many games can they expect if they try to do the research? You know, is it?
So if you do the research, there's probably about a dozen games at least right now. Maybe a dozen to maybe 15 or 16.
Uh huh.
It's like with anything though; it's a good toolbox to kind of know why are you playing this game. Because playing a game just to play a game is dumb.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
It's like doing those, you know, icebreakers at conferences or whatever, where you're like, what the heck? So, you know, having a purpose and knowing a purpose, that's really what we're going to talk about during this session is, you know, what is the purpose of this?
Right.
And then we'll go through actually how you do it and then debrief about, well, what was good and bad about that.
Right, right. Can you give an example about, like, a time when you maybe had a client who was – let's say in the debt they were doing really poorly and how games sort of came over to benefit them.
Yep. That speedboat one is one that I use fairly often.
Uh-huh.
And just recently last week I was at a client and they used this to really, instead of using a speedboat, we actually drew a sailboat, which still just looks like a crappy boat for me cause I'm not really a good artist. And, by the end of that, they really were able to identify the top five things, and they had probably hundreds of little sticky notes on this thing.
Oh, wow.
And it lasted about 4 hours to do this. And
oh,
by
wow.
By the end, they had a top five, and they were able to prioritize 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 of things that they were going to work on to help get a team better. So some of them were technical, so some of them were engaging in better feedback.
Mm-hmm.
So it comes back a lot to the collaboration and conflict resolution.
How long do these games typically last?
They can be pretty quick. They can be anywhere from, you know, 10 minutes to 3 or 4 hours.
Wow, is that's I'm assuming dependent on the size of the people, yeah, and all that. Yeah.
Yep. And really, what it is you want to get out of the game,
right?
And with any of the games, I find that the debrief or the retrospective after
retrospective.
It is vital.
Totally.
Or if you just play a game and then there's no purpose to it, people will get lost quickly.
And what goes on during a debriefing session?
It's almost like a mini retrospective.
A mini. Okay. Wow.
And so that, I use a lot of like Esther Jervey's format for that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, her five steps.
Gotcha. Very cool. So yeah, it sounds like a really interesting session. Let's just talk about the things in Agile. I mean, you've been in Agile in this space for a long time. I mean, what trends are you seeing that we should be aware of?
So from a testing perspective, I'm seeing testing getting a lot of love right now in the Agile space.
That's good.
It's weird because it didn't for a long time.
Right, right.
But a lot of people, when you said, you know, test-driven development, you know, they would say throw a bunch of testers in a room and that's test-driven development. Which we know is not true. And it's coming around to where I see a lot of Agile teams, the testers and the developers and architects and designers and DBAs are actually collaborating together. And it's less of a us versus them mentality.
Do you think that's just because more of the widespread acceptance of Agile that it's, what counts for that?
Part of it is that. Part of it is just I think people are not accepting working in silos anymore. When I first started doing this, there was a lot of contention between Agile versus Waterfall. Today, it's a lot between Agile versus Total Chaos. It's, you know, and some people don't even know what Waterfall is anymore, which is awesome to hear.
That's amazing. Just yeah. A totally new generation. They have no idea what it
is. Yeah, I mean, I've gone to a transition and they're like, what is this Waterfall you speak of, Mike? Hey.
Do they know what configuration management is, or is that just...
Oh, yeah. Yeah, but, you know, they're not looking at it from, you know, they're looking at it from the modern tool set, not, you know, whatever, you know, you used to use back for, like, OS2 development.
How about trends and tools? Is there anything... I mean, you said you're not fully in the technical aspect, but maybe is there something that you've been seeing?
Uh, Here's my main tool. Here, I'm not selling Post-it notes. I don't have stock in Post-it notes, but that's still my main tool.
That is the main tool.
Face-to-face collaboration.
Face-to-face, right. And you're seeing more of that these years as compared to the past, I'm assuming.
Yes, absolutely.
Gotcha.
And people are making more of an investment because they know it does pay off.
How about management? How is management acting in today's age, you know, with Agile? I mean, there's a lot of people that they say they want to be Agile, but then a lot of people say they don't get the support that they need from management.
Yeah. The job of managers is to grow and empower, which is a yucky word, their people. And help them become better, not to be command and control. And those that group of management is fading away. More and more, even in the large organizations, where I see still a big breakdown is at the strategic level. Let's say the senior vice presidents and above, who are looking at, you know, long term strategy,
yeah,
versus the director level, where it's all tactical. And what I'm finding is if you don't have that connection between the strategic and tactical, this is not going to work, because at the tactical level with directors, they get basically reorged every 9 months, and it's kill or be killed.
Right.
And that's how they move up. So that's a hard thing that I'm seeing still in the industry today. I know Michael Spade and Lisa Adkins are doing a lot of work right now in that space. So if you ever get a chance to talk to them or take a look at what they're doing.
Definitely. Very good resource. All right, so we're coming close to the end here. So I guess we'll just leave with a final question. What do you want session attendees to take away from your session?
Some new tools in the toolbox.
Sticky notes.
Sticky notes, yeah. No, not really. Just to be aware that there's other tools out there. You know, and just because you have a tool doesn't mean you have to use it all the time. And I see that a lot with, well, you know, I know Agile, so everything has to be Agile, and that's not really the case.
Gotcha. All right. Well, thank you, Michael, for taking time out of your day.
Thank you.
All right.
I appreciate it.
Yep, definitely.